I am mixing fresh chemistry, which is a good idea if you want archival prints. I keep a log of everything I do. And the working developer, I mix about a gallon and a half. And that's because I have these 20 by 24 trays, which comfortably holds a gallon and a half. So I mix a solution of a gallon and a half of working solution, and it turns out that that would be good for 128 8x10s. So a gallon and a half of developer, working solution developer, Dectol, I always make it with diluting one part of stock to two parts of water. And again, I make a gallon and a half, and that'll be good for 128 8x10 fiber base, double weight fiber base prints. So I keep a log of how many prints I make, and then when I get up to like 130 prints, 128 prints, then I discard it. And that way I know that the Dectol is never exhausted. Again, the paper fix I use is Kodak Rapid Fix, and I dilute that 1:5, and that's good for also 128 prints, that's a gallon and a half. So I keep a log of that. So pretty much I discard that, same time discard the, actually, the fixer is very strong, and I discard it same time I discard the Dectol, because they're both like 128 prints, but actually the paper fix is still good. And I use that for film, because the film you can see clear. The paper clears very quickly, but it's just safe to stop at 128 prints. That way, you also know that you don't need to fix more than 2 minutes. Your photographs, your paper prints. But then I keep the fixer and I use it for film. And I just, because the film you can see clear, and if it clears in 1 minute, you keep it in for another minute, the film is completely fixed. Hypoclearing agent, I make 2 gallons, because I usually soak at least 6 to 10 prints in there. So the 200 gallons of hypoclear is good for 400 8x10s. And the selenium toner, I dilute 1:9 from the stock solution, from the concentrate, then. And that's only good for 42 8x10s. It lasts longer if you tone longer, but if you tone more than double that, you'll get stains. So it's not recommended you overwork the selenium toner, but you can see the toner working on the prints and getting darker. So I usually tone more than 42 8x10s. It's expensive, this toner. So, but 1 gallon of toner, and I only mix 1 gallon because I tone one print at a time, so I don't need that much. Again, it's good for 42 8x10s. So if you're making 1 16x20, that's 4 8x10s. If you're making 1 20x24 inch print, that's equivalent to 6 8x10s. So that's how I keep track of my solutions. Today I'm mixing everything fresh. The stop bath, like I said, I have so much that I usually discard it. You know, I don't have to. But stop bath, I think I use 3 ounces to 1 gallon of water. And again, I make a gallon and a half. So, and the only other thing I use is, I use ammonia. I use an ammonia and a hydrogen peroxide mix. Let's see, I don't even have that written down here. I have it written down somewhere. But anyway, that's a last rinse. But you'll see. And that's, I discard that same time I discard the hypoclearing agent. And that helps to eliminate any remaining fixer in the prints. Okay. So I'm going to start mixing up the chemicals, and what I use is I use a bottle which is only used for water. So I can get 1 gallon, a gallon and a half, and this never gets contaminated with anything except water. And I pour it in, and I put, okay. So I don't think you need to watch me do that, but I wanted to explain that, okay. Okay, so I'm starting with, this is about 75 degrees water, 1 gallon. And I've got these large trays all over the darkroom because I use 5 trays. Developer, stop bath, fix. I have a water holding, and I have another batch of water which is used mainly for pre-soaking the paper before I put it in the developer, because the paper is really curly. I use 42-inch rolls by about 98 feet. I can purchase that from Ilford, and but problem is when you cut it, it's very curly. So I put it into the water to flatten it so it doesn't curl so much before I put it in the developer. So I have an extra tray of water just for soaking. Okay, so that's a gallon of water. Then with this graphics. So same for everything. That's how I mix. Okay, so I mix it in a tray, and I mix everything at about 75 degrees. It'll cool down. There's a heater in this room which brings it up to about 80 degrees, and everything settles at about 70. And I have a Kodak thermometer which I use to check temperature throughout. But you know, when you're processing paper, you keep it anywhere, you keep your solutions anywhere from 68 to 72 degrees, and you're pretty safe. Yeah, doesn't fluctuate too much from that. Okay, so now I'm going to get a gallon and a half. And for stop bath, I use 96 milliliters of my stop bath to 1.5 gallons of water. So let me do that. Which I bought before, years ago. The indicator stop bath changes color when it goes bad. But by the time it starts changing color, the stop bath is already not working, so it's not really a good idea to use indicator. But this is just what they sold at Gassers. And a rapid fix, you must have a stop bath, otherwise you'll get stains, because the stopping action of the rapid fix is going to occur in certain parts of the prints, certain part of the print before you submerge the whole thing. And that's how fast rapid fix is. So you have to have a stop bath. Some people don't use a stop bath at all if they're using a thiosodium sulfite, because it's not so rapid at acting. But I use rapid because it's easier to wash out. if you don't use a hardener, which I mentioned before. The last thing I'm going to do is the developer, which is 1 to 3. This is my developer tray. Stop, bath, fix. I'm going to put this tray over the sink. I'll show you how I do that. I might as well do that just so that you can see how I utilize my dark room. Dark room space is always a challenge. Every time I build a dark room, I've always had to make space. And this is a water bath. So, again, I've got my developer, which I'm going to mix now. Stop bath, fixer. This is going to be filled with water right over the sink so I can drain it easily. I can change that water fairly easily. And I have on these milk cartons, milk crates, a tray of water that I'm going to use to soften the emulsion and the paper, fiber base, so that it flattens out before I put it into the developer tray. Okay? And I also have the name this. This is a quarter-inch piece of plexiglass, which I place here. So I can always put another tray there, which I do, actually, when I wash. So I have another surface here that will hold a whole tray of 20x24. And that's how I utilize this darkroom, which is about, I say about 12 feet by 13 feet, 14 feet at most. I've got safe light here, which you can see. This is a daylight bulb. I only turn it on when I view my prints. Of course, I've got, which you've seen before, I've got a light box in here for looking at film. And I can also use that for viewing, because that's daylight too, and I use that for viewing prints. If I hold the prints out, I can use that. And then I've got another safe light up here. Okay. So when I turn everything off, I've got two safe lights in here. And here's my green light. Let's turn this on so you can see this. You can see that. That's a dark green safe light, and it is over my shoulder when I stand here to process film. So when I lean out of the way, the safe light I can look at the film for just a couple of seconds so I can grab it and put it into the stop bath and so forth. That helps a lot. And way in the beginning, I was talking about using green light to snip my film during testing so I can cut in between frames. That's the green light, okay? And through this door is my dark room. And my dark room has two red safe lights. I also have another light. So this is my dark room where I print, which is kept dry. I also have another light here, so you can see better, hopefully. I work sitting down, mostly because I don't have a ceiling height. In order to print 24 by 30, with this enlarger all the way up, a 4x5 neg will be able to print 24 by 30. And also, I like to sit down now because I'm old. I don't like to stand up as much. And another thing in here I want to show you. Let's put this here. If you can see this. This is my dodging tool. This is I inherited this from many years ago. I used to use this in the darkroom, my father's darkroom. You can make the size hole you want by moving these blades. And so when I burn, I can use this, and I can, if I, you know, a lot of times I'll just burn holding my hand, but if I need to block more light, I can use this. And you can also make this really small. I don't know if you can still find these. I think you can probably find these. I don't know if they're still making them, but, you know, you can make a pretty small hole with this too. So this is what I usually use for burning. This or just my hands. I'm not sure if you're going to be able to see me burn later when I print, because this camera doesn't work too well in the dark. But I use this. And then I have a sheet of, this is just black film. And I use this for testing. Also, I use this. You know, if I use this, I can block the paper and make steps along this edge. This is just black gator. Okay? And my enlarger, again, the most important thing about the enlarger is that it's aligned. So Richard Polotowski aligned it so that when I print here, all the way up, this is level, this is level, and this is level. This table is level. I use this for testing. I usually print with this 24 by 30 inch easel with blades, four blades. And you know, I've got all these. And then this is my paper dispenser. This holds, I cover it with black cloth, but there's a roll of paper in there, and it'll spit out and it'll cut. So I can cut, you know, 4 inches, 5 inches, whatever I need. One roll of paper is like, I don't know, almost $600. So you have to keep it in the dark. Cutter, we got a light tight drawer, light box, negative carriers here. There's a mixing chamber, my contact easels. So this is my dark room. Okay, that's it. I'll turn you back on after I have something to look at. Okay. Always clean the glass before I start printing. And I've got glass cleaner. And I use lighter fluid. Lighter fluid will take off gunk. So you have to use a soft tissue. And there's always some gunk, so you only need a few drops of this, and it'll dissolve any glue that might be stuck to the glass. Now, this tissue, even though it's soft, will leave pieces of tissue, so you have to get rid of that too. And the best way to do that is through looking at the reflection of the glass against light. And the reflection will catch, you'll be able to see the dust sitting on the glass. So presumably all the gunk is gone, whatever it was there. Then this is Windex. You can use, I have a bunch of lens cleaner and lens paper from Kodak, a bunch of it. But that is used sparingly on lenses. It doesn't do a very good job getting rid of gunk on glass because it's a very, as you can imagine, it's a very dilute form of detergent. Because lenses being so expensive, the lens cleaner is kept very mild. Okay, so now I have to clean this with more tissue. has to be completely dry. And I use a camel hair brush. All these static brushes that I bought years ago, and they're radioactive, so you have they're limited lifespan. But I keep them because I just like the brush. I don't care too much for them. So what I do is I look at the light, and when you catch the light on the glass, you can see a lot of dust here, and this takes it off very well. So catching a reflection in the glass allows you to see all the dust. Looks like there might be a scratch in this glass. Luckily it's on the edge. Let's say, so that's good. And you can't breathe because your breath will blow the dust around. You kind of have to hold your breath. And you move slowly as to not to raise the dust. Now, this is the mass negative. And again, you have to catch the reflection of the light to look for any dust. Of course, there's three sheets of film here. So hopefully when you sandwiched it, you didn't get too much dust in between. I probably did because I was fumbling with this stuff so much. So generally, from where it's hung up to dry, I take it straight from there and I sandwich it, thinking, okay. So this goes down right reading, emulsion down. Gingerly, you stick this into the enlarger, trying not to raise too much dust. Okay, so I want to move this camera here. Another thing I do is I turn the enlarger on and I lift the head and you look at the negative carrier from above, and you can also see if any dust fell on the glass, and now it's set. I open the lens and now I can focus and start to proceed, okay? So that's how I clean and set up a negative in the dark room. But still, I'm gonna have to spot. You always have to spot if you don't get rid of everything. And also, during the the loading of the film, especially if you're loading 4x5 film, you'll get dust in the camera. And if you have dust in on the film when you're photographing, you'll have an area that's blocked by light, blocking the light with dust. So when you make a print, you'll get a black speck on the print. And that always happens. Not always, but it happens quite often. So then when you make the print, you have to take a brush, which I'll probably finally, you take a fine brush. And this brush is what I've got in this bottle cap. I don't know if you can see that, but there's dried ferric cyanide in there, the bleach, the same bleach used in Farmer's Reducer. I wet the brush and I coat this brush with ferric cyanide. The print has to be fairly dry, so you have to wipe it down after you finish fixing it. And if you see a black speck, you have to touch that black speck with ferric cyanide to bleach that black out, which would then make that area of the print white. And during the spotting, you go back in and spot that. And that's how you get rid of black spots on your print, okay? All right. Okay. First test is out. And, you can see this. Okay, so the basic exposure is 60 seconds here. And then this is 75 seconds in this strip here. And this is 90 seconds. So 90 seconds is too dark. 75 looks okay for these leaves. Let me get the previous test. Now the previous test is dry. So it's got dried on, I'll be right back. Now, if you've been following along, this is masked. This is not masked. So I'm going to compare it with the masked one. But at this point, because these are all straight prints with a given starting contrast and all that, now that I'm printing, I can do anything I want. I can burn, I can dodge, I can change the filter, I can change the contrast if I want. And looking at just this strip, comparing the same area, it's very close. It's a little bit snappier. I could cut back on the exposure, but I don't think I will. Instead, I'm going to dodge now, because if you remember, I wanted to keep whatever, not details much, but whatever tones that were in this black area is just going completely black here. But I masked it to hold it. And so I'm going to dodge this area and use 75 seconds. I know I'm going to want this darker, so but I'll do that in the final print. But right now I'll make another test strip and I'll show you how I proceed, okay? Okay, this is 75 seconds. And I just continually dodged down here throughout the exposure. And I can tell you that if I had done that, continually dodged without these masks in place, this would indeed be lighter. But the blacks wouldn't be so good. You'd be getting these muddy blacks. You wouldn't have the local contrast, in other words, just in this area. And that's because the density difference between these spots of light areas and the blacks has been increased by the mask. So when I dodge, even though I lighten the whole area, the blacks are still getting so much exposure that they remain black. So local contrast doesn't suffer. That's one of the main things that the mask did. The secondary mask on this gave me the sparkle in where I wanted it. Now I'll probably burn this down somewhat because this looks I still have to look at this one more time. And I learned a trick a long time ago. There was a documentary. I'm gonna grab the camera. Okay, so we're gonna go outside now. Take the camera. And this area has red light on right now. And I'll go to the microwave. And I'm gonna microwave this so that it'll dry in 1 minute. That's why I have a microwave here. Just keep this falling down. And there was a documentary. Ansel Adams working in the dark room. He used a microwave to dry his print in 1 minute, and then he could see how much it darkened during, because every paper has a different amount of dry down, which means that when it dries, the print gets a little darker. So he does this as a way to predict how the print will look when it's actually dry. That's one of the things that he utilized it. It's the new technology at the time, microwaves. I think that film was probably in the early 80s, late 70s. But then, and then also over here, I've got a Macbeth proof viewing system. So this is how I evaluate my prints in this booth here, which is designed for looking at prints. Actually, it's designed for mostly for color work. But so then I come here and I look at this, and I make a final adjustment either on contrast. Sometimes I'll test it again, but. Okay, so these are my straight prints. No mask. And this is the final print. And I knew that I wanted it darker than this, so I'm not shooting for the, besides this is a straight print. This camera show what I want. Between this out of focus leaf and that background, which is even more out of focus, and then the blacks. And sometimes I'll just sit here and look at it and think about it. I'm gonna cut 10% exposure, and I'll do some burning, continue with the dodging. Maybe I'll dodge a little slower and get more effects from the dodging. Yeah. Then I'm gonna make a full size print. Now I can see all these spots here. 3-4 spots here. Dust spots already. And there's some stuff sticking out from the branch here. I'll spot that too. But anyway, yeah, I'll cut 10% and I'll make a full size print. This is gonna be a 16 by 20. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna cut the roll paper out. I'm gonna cut 17 17 and a half inches. And then I'll fold the paper over, cut it in half. So I have 17 and a half by 21, because the paper is 42 inches wide. So I'll have a bump. And then I'll have extra around, stick it in the easel. The blades will hold it flat. I have to tape it down because it's so curled. You're not gonna be able to see that because the lights, this camera doesn't work in the dark, so I apologize again. But I'll turn it on when the prints are ready to look at. Okay, so it's still wet, of course. If you can see this. And you can, I hope that you can see the detail down, you know, the separation between the blacks and the detail down there. The fall off now, where it gets out of focus, and where I wanted the highlights to be from the secondary mask is having its effect. I'm not going to make another print. This is a good example of a lot of work into something that ultimately doesn't work, for me anyway. But it serves its purpose in as an example of an image where I increase the contrast in one area and I lower the contrast in another area. So mask can do both. And that's why I shot this and that's why I used this image. So I'm going to switch to the other image of the Venetian blinds, okay? We'll continue there. Okay, so this test is out. And now, this is 30 seconds, 34 and 38 seconds. So this picture on the wall looks pretty good. I mean, it's, I don't want it to be so light that you can see it, that your eye goes to it. But the Venetian blinds are still, I mean, I can see it, but you have to struggle to see. So I need more exposure to get this. And what I decided to do on this was to get this exposure correct and just dodge, because it's easy to dodge. If this gets, this area gets too dark, it's easier to dodge. And also this shadow, this moving shadow is too light. So I know overall I'm gonna need more exposure, at least 20%. So I'm gonna make another, test with maybe 22% more exposure. And then I'll microwave that to dry it and check it out. Okay? And I'll be back. Okay, so here's the last test. And it looks pretty good. I find that when I make enlargement, that this is made with 22 magenta in the filter head, which is my normal for number two paper. And this is made with 22 magenta as well. And it's a little lower in contrast. And I've found that whenever I make enlargements, if I do want to match this, I always have to add a little bit more contrast, maybe just because it's larger, the grains spread out, I don't know. But it looks better than this. And you can see easily the Venetian blinds. Here, it starts to disappear in this print, although it's there if you look closely. But here, even from 15 inches away, I can see it. And I can see the sunlight coming in between the blinds here. So I like to be able to look into prints, you know, about 4 or 5 inches away, as well as from a distance. And this looks just about right. The shadow looks just about right. This is lighter than this, so I don't need to dodge that much. Keep in mind that this is printed on grade 2 paper, which is designed for negatives that have a density range over an overall density range of at least 1.6, 1.65. That's my aim. The detail has to fall within 0.75. And then you're able to see easily this area to, the shadows. Now, this negative is much greater, 1.65, which ensures you a good black to white. So you can have, you can always have more than 1.65. The problem is you lose local contrast here. Now, when I dodge here, it will flatten everything, but because there's very good density range just within this area, even if I dodge it, you'll still maintain your decent blacks. This strip of light coming through these Venetian blinds, I can see detail here, whereas on the original print without mask, it's almost pure white. But now I can see shades of gray in this strip, and that's because of the mask. The mask is perfect. There's no way that I can burn just these spots in. But the mask can do that. The mask can hold and dodge perfectly. And when you look at this close, there's no sign of a mask. There's no misregistration because the mask is soft and it's pin registered. And there's two masks on top of the original neck here, if you recall. So now I'm gonna make a full size print. This gradation, these white things here, those are magnets. The paper is so curly that I have to use magnets because the base of the easel is metal. So I'm able to hold it flat. But that gradation from this to this pure white here is very nice. You can't really see it in the camera, in the video, but this came out just about right. And also, I don't know if you can see this, but the chair here separates from the wall very clearly because that's where the mask cut. Remember, I bleached it until this became clear and that remained black. So now you have this good separation here. So all in all, it's a very successful mask, although it may not be a very successful photograph. But again, it serves its purpose. This was an extreme example of very contrasty lighting where I was still able to expose normally and process normally. I didn't have to do normal minus processing in order to maintain the density range. I did that through masking, and in fact, keeping the density range high from the blacks to pure whites because of the masking. I hope that all makes sense. Let me get the previous print. Okay, so this is no mask. And you can see this, but the Venetian blinds here are visibly, I mean, you can easily see this. Here you have to struggle to see it. And you don't see anything here at all. These lights here, you only see the highlights. You don't see the whole unit that holds the light bulb. And here you can clearly see it. All that is due to the mask. So in this case, the mask did quite a bit, although when you look at it, it just looks like a decent print. I mean, it just looks like well done. But if you're a photographer and you know the struggle that you would come across with such contrasty lighting, you might appreciate it more and wonder how it was done. Well, masking is how it was done, okay? Okay, so now I'm gonna make the full size 1620. I'll be back. Here's the print. So, I am I'm going to make another print because this one I like enough. I don't know what I'm going to do with it, but this bothers me, this little knob there. I couldn't see that, but that's a little distracting. So I'm going to bring the blade down. But other than that, it looks about right. Now this is going to be toned, so the blacks are going to get a little deeper. Maybe a little more dodging. I don't know. This is very nice. That movement of the leaves is pretty subtle. I think I would have liked more, but you never know. You're using 4 seconds, you know, and how much it moves. I mean, I shot like 4 or 5 of these, and this one had the best movement. Yeah, so I'm going to fix that and make another print. Now, I will be back. Hang on. Back of water. Okay, and I also wanted to mention that I develop anywhere from 2 minutes to 3 minutes, minimally 2 minutes, in Dectol, diluted 1 to 2. And the only reason why I might develop longer is because it looks a little light. And I know that if I go to 4 minutes, it'll gain quite a bit more density. But I don't do it to adjust the contrast, because I'm always printing with multi-grade now. I used to print with number 2 paper, number 3 paper, sometimes 4. And then adjusting the development time will affect the contrast, but I can't get number 2, number 3 paper in rolls of 42 inch or 50 inch. This you can actually get in 50 inch. It's so expensive that you save about 20% by buying roll paper. The only way I can get number 2 paper is by sheets, and it's really expensive. Besides, the multi-grade paper is so good now. I remember 30 years ago, I wasn't able to get this kind of D-Max on a multi-grade. You know, I was getting 2.2, now I'm getting 2.4 toned. So, the stop bath I use for 1 minute. Fresh stop bath, that's enough. I fix, Ilford recommends only 30 seconds because then you fix it to completion and you don't have to wash it very long. Yeah, they recommend like 10-15 minutes of washing with hypoclearing agent. But I ran some tests with fresh fixer, and I just made some strip tests, and I fixed it for 10 seconds, 20 seconds, 30 seconds. And indeed, 30 seconds works if you're with constant agitation, but only for small prints. It doesn't work for large prints. So for 16x20, 20x24, I fix for 1 minute. I flip it over so it doesn't face the light. I flip it over and then I turn the room lights on. And after 1 minute, I flip it over and I fix for another minute. So I fix for a good 2 minutes. Now the edge of the paper is really where the fixer will seep in most. So all my prints are oversized so that I trim off 1/8 inch, 1/4 inch all around. And that gets rid of the edge where you can't wash the fixer out. But yeah, so I fix for 2 minutes and I don't fix for 30 seconds like Ilford recommended. Unless you're making 5x7s, I guess it's okay, but, 5x7s, that's only a test for me, a proof for me. Okay, and I had mentioned that I had prints up on my wall for over 35 years, and I brought that in. I'm also showing you. This here is shot by Lenny Lynn, who Lenny is a great photographer, friend of mine, and I learned a lot from too, as well as from Frank Wing. And Lenny allowed me to use his 35 millimeter transparency to make an internegative. So I made a 5x7 internegative from his 35 millimeter slide. And then when I masked it, I deepened these areas to accentuate the shape that he saw when he shot this. So this is a contact print from a 5x7, actually it's a 5x7 negative on 8x10 sheet film. And this has been up for at least 30 years. It's printed on my favorite paper, which is the Agfa Portriga. So it's a little bit warm tone, selenium toned. And it had a 2.5 black. This paper had the deepest black. And after 35 years on my wall, and there's no glass here, because I liked it so much, I didn't want it behind glass. Got kind of smudged, unfortunately. Somewhere I've got this name. It looks really good. It looks really good after all those years. I don't know if you can see the separation. My masking back then wasn't as good as it is now, but I knew I could deepen blacks. So I deepened all these areas to isolate this, because a slide, I might have the slides, a dupe of the slide somewhere. So that's my Lenny Lind. And then this was also on my wall since 1981. And this I shot. This is a contact print. So I shot a log with water running, and they're different exposures. This was probably at eighth of a second. So I'm shooting straight down on a log that's embedded in these rocks. It's shot in my driveway when I lived in Pacifico. So this is like an eighth of a second. And then this is, I think this is like 1 second. So there's more movement. And I even had my wife was laying down here. Her hair is running away. So her hair is moving with the water, so you get more movement. And then this one was shot, I think this was like 60 seconds. So water's running throughout, but here it looks dry. Well, the water's not running really fast, but, and this looks almost like fire or something. So I shot a bunch of these, and these three were the ones I chose to print. And it always bothered me when I was younger that the edges of my 35 millimeter frame, where the sprocket holes were, was always blacker than any black inside the print. And so this was an assignment I gave myself, where I printed a maximum black here. So this 11x14 black in my print was 5 exposures. 1, 2, 3 exposure. The fourth exposure was this black border, which was indeed a D-max. And then I had another arch film that exposed these these lines. And the idea was to create so much contrast that the blacks inside this print would rival the D-max of these borders. This was a 2.4 black. This is on the Ilford Galleria number 2 paper, and I achieved a 2.4, and I'm able to measure this right here. And another thing is, this is orthochromatic film, and I developed in a pyro developer. A pyro developer is a tanning developer, and it only works on thick emulsion films. It doesn't work on a pyro developer doesn't work on these thin emulsion films. So the browner the nape, you're printing like through a safe light now, because paper is non-sensitive to
red, brown. You have brown safe lights, right? So I spent maybe a month doing this. And I was pleased with it. I made 12. This is number 7. Which I don't know what happened to the other 11 prints. I might have one more somewhere. And 2 years ago, I took the glass out and replaced it with museum glass. So this is museum glass. So I started with 2.4 in 1981. And 2 years ago, when I measured this black, it was down to 1.9. So in fact, the blacks have changed after so many years. But it still looks black, very black. And it's been out on the wall with sunlight coming into the room for over 35 years. 86 would have been 35 years. I mean, 2016. So this has been up all that time, and the whites look good, the blacks look good. Now this has been going, this has gone through the same treatment that I'm going to show you when I finish these prints and I wash them and so forth. So I know that a single bath of rapid fixer, fixed for only 2 minutes, works. It is indeed completely fixed and completely washed with the washing procedure I'll show you. And even though it changes, only the densitometer can tell. And the last thing I will say is, this is mounted. Back then, I was using a heat mounting press and I mounted this and framed it. If it wasn't mounted, I could rewash it. Of course, my signature here, which is neither here nor there, would wash off, but washing the print would allow me to retone it. And if I tone it again, I will be able to bring that 1.9 back up to 2.1. And I've done that with prints that are unmounted. So that's why now I don't mount. So those are the two prints that have been on my wall all these years. And this is when I kind of got interested in movement and stillness. So this, in my mind, was movement and stillness never ending. There's movement here, but it's such a long exposure that it looks still. There's more movement here because it's blurry here because, whatever. And there's a little bit of movement here. But all this is not, all of the rocks are very sharp, very, it's a contact print. Pyrone eggs are very grainy, so this wouldn't hold up to enlargements. But, like a 20 by 24, it would look pretty grainy. This was I think I used matrix film to shoot this, I'm not sure. Anyway, so those are the two prints that have been on the wall for over 35 years and still look good. And it allows me to recommend the archival processing and washing procedure that I'm about to show you. Okay, so I'm going to print another 16x20, and then I'll print one more night just because I'm already tired of talking while I'm printing and doing it. It takes a lot out of me. Getting old. All right, I'll be back. Okay, so this is the second print. Another 15 seconds, and it'll have been in the fixer for 2 minutes. It's important you give constant agitation. That's why I only make one print at a time. You put stacks and you have to. You're not sure you're gonna get. Then you, in order to be safe, you have to give it even longer, prolonged fixing time because it might be sticking together. So I do one print at a time. I don't do that thing where you print 100 and process, try to process 30 prints at once. I give it a 15 second rinse,
and it goes into a holding bath. And as far as I can see, I'm done with these two nags. I'm going to print one more. I always have nags that I haven't printed yet, but I only have three prints here. And if I'm going to stand here for an hour and wash, I'm also washing more than three prints. So you'll notice that I got rid of that little knobby on the ceiling there. And yeah, even though this is double weight paper, it still can be easily crinkled. So you gotta be careful. I don't really see any black spots, black dust things. You know, I see little things. I think, you know, the Venetian blind wasn't clean. That's the spots I'm seeing here. You know, it's not really sharp, like a piece of dust. Anyway, I don't think I'm gonna do anything with this print anyway, so. But that's it. Good detail up and down. I mean, during a dry down, this is gonna be quite a bit clearer. That's what I noticed. The selenium toning would deepen the blacks. You don't notice anything from here, from the toning. Although that might change from paper to paper, but given this paper, that's what I noticed. So that's it. This is the half dome that Robert Cameron shot in color, and I printed it in black and white, and I put it on the wall there. It's a mirror, so it's reflecting. Yeah. It's the movement of the palm leaves outside that attracted me to this when I was walking by. It was moving a lot though, and this hasn't moved that much, so. Okay, so until I start washing, I'm not going to turn the camera back on, because when I print this next print, it's a negative that I kept making again, because I couldn't get what I wanted. So now I'm finally happy with this third neg, and there's no masking. There's no masking on this neg, so I'm just gonna print it. Print a couple prints and I'll start cleaning up, okay? Okay. Turns out I ran out of paper. So I couldn't even make one more print. So I only have three prints to wash. And I cleaned up all the trays. This is just water here. It's in the holding bath. And over here, this tube is filtered water. I have a filter system here and a temperature control unit. So it's running between 68 and 75 degree water, and it runs at a minute and a half per minute. So I have a flow meter here, so I know in 1 minute I'll get a gallon and a half of water. The middle tray, I'm going to put a selenium toner in there. First of all, I'm gonna switch this around here. Let's see. So in the corner here, I've got a timer that I look at, and I know that if I run the water for a minute, I'll get a minute and a half, I'll get a gallon and a half of water. So I'm constantly looking at that timer for reference. And the middle tray, I'm going to put selenium toner now, okay? So I have to mix that. Let me do that first. Okay, so I dilute 1 to 9. So I want 4 liters. Four liters is 4,000 milliliters. So it's 1 liter. Air out from above the trays. I'm going to add enough water to make 1 liter. And then 1 more liter of water. So I have a total of 400 milliliters, 4,000 milliliters. 4 liters solution, which is just over a gallon. This stuff is almost $30 a bottle now. And you'll notice that I use one specific graduate just for developer, one funnel just for developer, and everything else is, for the other chemicals. Okay, so now all I need is 1 minute. So just looking at the timer, I toned this for 1 minute. I do use my hands. You're not supposed to, but I've been doing it for so long. I'm just used to it. I can use tongs, but then I don't want to have to get special tongs just for selenium toner. I don't have that. The toner actually converts the metallic silver. Somehow, it makes it more impervious to contaminants in the air, so it adds archival quality. But it also deepens the black. It usually stops at zone 1. It doesn't really affect zone 2 as much. Okay, so this is 1 minute. I only have one print of this, because I didn't make more than one print, so I can't really compare it. But that's toned now. Okay. So this is the other image, and hopefully you'll be able to see a difference, because I do have 2 prints of this. And try to stand out of the way so you can see. When I've done my fade tests, this particular paper goes from a 2.2, 2.1519 to 2.4 with toning. So you gain a 2-stop, you gain 2/3 of a stop with toning. But after 6 months in the window, it goes back down to 2.1.
And after 1 year, you're at 1.9, which is equivalent to like 30 years on the wall, right? But the Tony walls bring it back up 2/3 of the stop. So that's 1 minute. And throw this in the water. Rinse it. And then I'll take this print. This is untoned. This is toned. So, yeah, it goes a little bit blue too. I don't know if you can see that. It's standing in your way. But if you look at this area here, compare it to this area here, you can see it. Okay, so that's as much as I tone. Now you can always tone longer and get more of an effect, but I don't want the color that I get when I tone longer. So I only tone for 1 minute. And although I can smell the toner, it's not that bad. You have to have a waterproof floor. I laid down a piece of waterproof linoleum in here because in the first dark room that I worked in, which my father had built in 1957, he had wooden planks on the end, so you would be standing on these wooden studs, so to speak, and it would it was sitting above a cement garage floor. That after 25 years, that wooden material starts to rot away. So okay, so this is toned, and I'll let it sit in the water. I pour the toner back into my selenium toner container. Now, I know I toned 3 16 by 20, so I have to mark that down on my journal so I know when the toner has to be replaced. I put the mop sink here so that I can lean these large trays up against this processing table I built, and I can just drop the bottle into the mop sink so I don't have to bend over and save my back. So this dark room is designed for a one person dark room, and it works really well. So once this goes in, I put the toner away. And then I check the prints for any black spots. If there are dust spots on the negative or black, this is where I will use a ferric cyanide on a tip of a sable brush and bleach out that black. Then I'll go into the hypoclearing agent. But I only have 3 prints. Now I have to turn off the camera here to wash this tray. Okay, so now I've got hypoclear in that water, in that middle tray here, this tray here. And the hypoclear, I mix 2 gallons because usually I have a whole stack of prints. I have like 8 to 10 prints in here. But I only have 3 prints, so. But still, it's good for 400 8x10s. this is not freshly mixed, it's still good. And this has to sit in here for 5 minutes with constant agitation. So I just take the bottom print and move it to the top. Usually I have the radio running, so at least I have music to listen to. But the last video I did had the radio running, and it had Christopher Parkering playing a classical guitarist, Christopher Parkering playing Mozart's theme from the Magic Flute with variations by Fernando Sor. And YouTube flagged me and said that it was okay that the owner of the copyright would allow me to use it. Because it's just background music. And so this time I decided to just turn off the radio. I'll add my own guitar music because I own the copyright for all that stuff from the Guitar Society. It's less of a hassle. So it takes a good 5 minutes or so to neutralize the solution. It leaches out the fixer that's in a print and it goes into the solution until it reaches an equilibrium of material, and then so the amount of fixer that's left in the print has been reduced. It takes about 5 minutes according to everything I've read. So I'll keep it in here for 5 minutes. I have to put it into this water tray. There's another water tray here, fresh water over here. And then I'll empty this. Actually, I can discard that. I'll remove the hypoclaring agent back into the bottle. And then I only need 2 trays now after that. Then I just fill this with fresh water. After 5 minutes in this tray, I put it into the fresh water and I do this for 5 minutes. This is, the water is exchanged in that tray. And every 5 minutes, I put it into a fresh tray. So it goes through 5 changes of water, which gives it a good half hour of washing. Then I soak it for 5 minutes in the hydrogen peroxide ammonia solution. I should have to look up that formula for you. And I soak it for 5 minutes in there, and then I do another 3 rinses, 15 more minutes. And then we're done. All together, it's a little over an hour when you consider the toning and everything else. But the prints will last. And what a lot of people don't know is a black and white print like this will last a very long time. I mean, quite honestly, I mean, when I print now, I'm not even thinking of making prints for anyone, because I'm not selling anything. I mean, so, but after the, I don't know, you know, the story of Noah, right? After the great cataclysm comes, it could conceivably be that in 1,000 years, someone will discover some of my prints and it'll still be there. You'll still have something to look at. Because the best estimate for this kind of black and white print made on fiber-based paper, correctly washed and everything, has a minimal image longevity of 3,000 years. When I read that, I thought, wow,
3,000 years. That doesn't mean that it's not going to change, but it means that you'll still be able to see something. So that's 5 minutes. I'll transfer it. Actually, I should transfer this tree. Fresh water. I should throw away this water. So this is why I did this, so it's really convenient. I just pour it into the mop sink. Break my back lifting this tray. Alright, so now this gets poured back into the hypoclaring agent container. I think thus far I've only used this solution for less than 100 prints. I don't change after 400 prints. I mean, this hypoclaring agent is not that expensive, so after 200 prints I change it. And, you know, ammonia and hydrogen peroxide is not expensive either. So I change them both at the same time. I don't go to 400 prints. If you don't use your chemicals for a long period of time, like, you know, years, 6 months, a year, and you'll see stuff growing in it. So, you can't just go by how many prints you've made. You have to consider how long it's been sitting in these bottles. You can actually see these clouds of, looks like dust growing in your chemicals if you leave long enough. Okay. So now it's just water for a while. And camera's there, so I can't use it.
about 3 3 gallons. And then this is the last of the rinse. And then this one I toss into the mop sink. I get my ammonia and hydrogen peroxide mix. So this is the last chemical that I use, and I wanted to give you the formula for this because I don't have it in my head. You think I would? All this time. This book, Caring for Photographs. This is not the only book that I recommended ammonia and hydrogen peroxide, but this one gives you a formula. Okay. It talks about testing for fixer left in the print, and it says, turn off the radio. Even though the test indicates all fixer is gone, a trace remains and must be eliminated with a bath that is mixed just before use. 16 ounces, I don't do that. 16 ounces of water with 4 ounces of 3% drugstore hydrogen peroxide and 3.25 ounces of dilute ammonia solution. 1 part 28% drugstore ammonia mixed with 9 parts water. Be careful with this working solution. It must be kept in an open container. If closed, gases created could crack the bottle. Agitate the print in a tray of this solution for 6 minutes. Rinse and wash for 20 minutes, and then you're done. So that's where I got it. In the other book that I mentioned, written by Kodak people, also recommended, but they didn't tell you exactly how to mix it. And what I do, and they also recommended, just ammonia works. Ammonia, which is an alkaline solution, works well to eliminate hypo. So when I process my films, in the last tray, after I rinse it, after I wash it with water, I put a cap full of ammonia in there and let it soak for 5 minutes. It can't hurt. Film is plastic, so it doesn't have as much an issue with washing, because this paper fiber will soak up the fixer and get embedded in there. Especially in the back, as well as in the emulsion, but mostly in the back of the fiber base. And that's why photographic paper is made so stringently, under stringent conditions. They try to make the fibers really tight so it doesn't soak up chemicals as much as, you know, just regular cardboard or paper. Even though it's 100% cotton, they make it really tight. That's why the photographic paper is so expensive, especially double weight. Okay, so I'm gonna soak it in here for 5 minutes. Okay. Now, this has been sitting here. This is the last water rinse. And this is a piece of plexiglass. 4 by 30 inches. And this is my squeegee. And now I squeeze in the crimp. Obviously, everything here has to be clean, so nothing really touches this except prints. And at this point, I take the print, put it on the plexiglass. Always rinse the print in case there's any grit. If there's any grit on the print and squeeze, you're going to scratch the print. So take off the bulk of the water. And then I put it on my drying rack, which I will show you in a second. There's only three prints, so I might as well let you watch me squeegee all three prints. I didn't run out of paper before I was able to make this image. But that roll of 98 feet went, it took me about 4 months to go through it. Maybe 5 months. Okay, so I'm going to move the camera. Let's see what I'm doing here. That's my drawing lab. So I put a face up and it'll fit like 4 16 by 20s on each one of these. These are just window screens. And I let it air dry. Tomorrow I'll show you, they dry curled. And so I use this mounting press. I don't mount anymore, like I said, but I use it to flatten the prints. And I'll show you that. So we'll do that tomorrow. And that's it. All together, let's see. It's 2:30. I came down here at 9:30. 5 hours to make three prints. But then, you know, I was talking and moving the camera. Normally I'll spend about 5 to 6 hours and I'll get 8 prints done from 3 nays. But that's after all the maskings. Okay, so that's it for now. Tomorrow we'll talk about flattening the prints and then spotting. And that's about it. Wow, finally got through all these lessons. All right. I thought I'd turn the camera back on and let you see what I'm doing.
I'm disassembling this print. It's been on the wall for 35 years. I'm just curious. So I took the frame apart. And this is the calibration pack, the calibration plaque, 0.07 for the white, and this should be 1.84 for the black, 1.84. So this is calibrated. So the densitometer is, if you've been following all along, it's an objective way of measuring densities on both transmission films, films that transmit light, as well as prints reflecting. So this started at 2.5, and this is the reason why I'm going to measure the black right here. This is after 35 years on the wall. 2.16. So it held all these years from 2.5 to 2.16. Now, if you recall, the Ilford paper went from 2.4 to 1.9, and I can get back 2.1 if I selenium tone the Ilford paper now if it wasn't mounted. But this, the AGFA Portriga paper, is indeed the best paper ever made. Silver gelatin input anyway. And It's just gorgeous. I mean, it's got so much tonality. It looks more three-dimensional. And a couple of years ago, I still had this paper. It was 11 by 14. I had maybe 20 sheets. And when I was really happy with the Louis Armstrong negative, I used up my remaining paper printing the Louis Armstrong image on this paper, and it still looks better. That's another thing. After all those years, the AGFA Portriga paper still printed beautifully. It didn't spoil. And I made maybe 8 prints, 10 prints, maybe a dozen. I don't know. And I had a Kickstarter. I was trying to raise money to build a darkroom so I could accommodate my 10x10 enlarger. And I didn't meet my goal. But I took 2 of the prints on the Portriga paper, Louis Armstrong, and I sent one to Ken Burns, who did the documentary on jazz, and I sent another one to Wynton Marsalis, and both of them were crazy about Louis Armstrong, and Ken Burns was saying that Louis Armstrong was the single most important musician from America that changed the face of popular music. So I thought they'd appreciate it. Got a very nice email back from Ken Burns. I'm gonna cough. Anyway, he had a statement which I read, asking people to support film photography, analog process, that it was important. And Wynton Marsalis, on the other hand, not him personally, but his group of people, I guess, sent me a letter. It looked like a form letter, saying, "I'm sorry. We can't do what you asked because of what you asked," basically. "And any unsolicited materials that we receive will be returned to you along with this letter." Well, I got the letter, but I never got my print back. So, I hope he's enjoying it anyway. But I printed that on the Portriga, and I wish this paper is still around. It's really beautiful. After all these years, it still looks so good. But, you know, And Ilford does make a warm tone, but nothing like this. And you know, you get spoiled using this old paper. Anyway, I took it out of the frame just to measure it because I was curious. Because I knew that the the gallery number 2 paper from Ilford faded in 35 years from 2.4 to 1.9. And now I know that the Portriga faded from 2.5 to 2.16, which you can't even get back. Even on the Galleria paper, even if you selenium tone it, you can only give about 2.1. So anyway, that's it. I turned the camera back on just to, because I was going to do this. I wanted you to get the benefit of the results. Okay. This is how the prints look after they're dried. So they're pretty early. There's only 3, but you can see they're not flat. That's because there's no plastic in this paper. So it dries much like a towel would. It's mostly cotton fiber. And below, I've got my mounting press. And I've turned this on, so it's warmed up. And the button opens up. And all the moisture has been removed from this cardboard because the heat dries it. It's been on the foam for at least 15-20 minutes, so it's very hot. It's like a giant iron you would use for ironing clothes. And it's important to clean this every time before you use it. Because if you have any particles, it'll get embedded in the emulsion when it dries. It'll make a dimple in your print. Then you'll have to re-soak the print to remove it, dry it again, and so it's kind of, this is a glossy paper, so it's a, got a fairly decent gloss to it. I can put 2 prints in here at once. I've got a timer going, so when I press the plate down, I only need to dry for 1 minute. Temperature. It gets very hot. So normally this equipment is used for as a dry mounting press, and manufacturers like Kodak sell an adhesive that comes in a sheet, and once heat is applied to that sheet, it melts it into a glue. And traditionally that's how you mount fiber-based prints, archivally. I've noticed over the years, though, that the adhesive does turn yellow. So when the glue goes beyond the print onto the mount on the mounting cardboard, you'll see a little bit of glue on the edge. And it'll appear yellow after a couple of years, a few years. So now it's flat. Okay. And I always look at the reflection on the emulsion, make sure there's no dimples. Otherwise I have to dry mount it again. So I'll place this here and do the next ones. Here to Since it's a large piece, I can do two at once.
So I just do both of these.
In my viewing booth and see what we got. Now obviously it still needs to be trimmed and spotted, which I don't do here. I have another location because I couldn't fit everything into this small lab here. So I do all my finishing, spotting, trimming, framing, and if I do any mounting at all, I'll do it at the other location. The only things I mount really are the color inkjets if I have them, if somebody wants something in color. But the fiber-based prints, I try not to mount. I guess if I start making really large prints, I'll have to mount it. And I'm tempted to use it, so I'm gonna turn this off because I don't need it anymore. So now it's flat. Some people will use blotting paper to dry prints and to make them flat. Okay, so I'm going to move the camera over here. Okay. So let's just take a look at this. This is straight print, and you can see how dark this is, and this is pure white. You can kind of see the Venetian blinds here. I don't know how close this camera focuses, but and this, now you've got all this opened up and clearly the Venetian blinds go all the way. You can see the white sunlight coming through this blind all the way through here. So, and even though I dodged to lighten that, the mask is giving me good local contrast here, so I have good separation here. If I didn't have a mask, it'd be muddy. All that dodging would just give you less than black. Okay. So from a standpoint, just technically speaking, this is remarkable because the brightness range between this and this is so great that although the film can record it, the paper, you'd have to, if you were to lighten this, you'd have to burn, and you'd never be able to burn this clearly. Get some detail, but you wouldn't get this kind of print. And then this one, if you recall, I got the separation here in the background, and then I've burnt this down. And what I wanted was just what I focused on to be sharp and brilliant, and everything else is subdued. Although the print doesn't really work for me, I mean, I did what I set out to do with it. Okay, so I don't know if you can see that. Catch your reflection. Yeah. I've got magnets on the wall here. So that's it. So now I'm going to transport these to Pacifica, where I work out of the garage there. I'll show you how I finish the print.
Okay.
Okay, here we are in the garage where I do some of my finishing work. So I'll take the print trimmer and here are the three prints that I flattened with the mounting press. And I'm just going to align this up, take off this strip, which would presumably still have some chemicals in the just the edge of the print. So I remove that by just cutting away. That's why I also like to work with oversized paper, because I know that I'm going to cut these down. And if I work with set paper, like if I buy a box of 16 by 20, I know that I'm going to be cutting off a good portion of it, and the print paper will wind up being smaller. And likewise, if I use a print washer, which are only made up to 20 by 24, it won't fit this paper because this is larger than 20 by 24. But I can always cut it down to be 20 by 24 as a final size. And to be honest with you, I don't care what size the paper is at the end. I just want to cut off the edges to get rid of any contaminants. When you buy artwork, they'll always list like the size of the image, you know, to like a 32nd of an inch, and they'll indicate the size of the paper. But I don't pay attention to that. Each print is a little bit different sizes. I don't worry about what exact size I'm getting. I just want to make sure that there's no contaminants left in the paper when I'm done. And so even if I make, you know, four prints, they're going to be different size, because I just take off the edge and I don't worry about why they do that. They worry about the size of the paper. One of those galleries for you. Collectors, you know, they worry about stuff that doesn't always make sense. Okay, so these three are trimmed, and presumably there's no more contaminants left in the image. And these prints will last a very long time. Now, I don't know how well you can see this. I'll move the camera. This camera probably doesn't focus too close, but there are spots here. There's at least, I don't know, 15, 20 dust spots. So now I'm going to set up and show you how I spot, which is not very exciting, but anyway. So this is where I do spotting. And a smaller bowl, but anyway, this is to hold water. You don't need much. This is my brush. These are spot tone colors, because I can spot color too. What you do in colors, you mix to get, you blend these colors together to get the hue you want to spot on the color prints. I'm only doing black and white, so I mainly use this. So
this, you wet the brush, and if you want a warm tone, you can mix a little bit warm and cool tones to get the right black you want. And you use a tissue to dry the brush. The brush is almost dry before you. And it helps to have a piece of paper, which I have to find. You have photographic paper. You can test the color to get the tone you want. And then I usually use a piece of, hang on, let me get everything together. I'll turn you back on. Okay. Because your hand goes right up, you need a piece of paper to rest your palm on as you come up the spot. And you just touch it, and you see the density come up, and you stop when it matches the surrounding area. There's no quick way to do it. If you spot too fast, you'll inevitably see it. Now, I always spot really close, and when I was younger, I used to wear this. And from this distance, well, I could still use it. You can see very clearly I usually spot from this, from the edge of the white speck towards the inside. And I can tell you that this print, being as large as it is, it's going to take anywhere from 20 minutes to half an hour to spot everything. As I get older, I find that I don't need this. Now I just take off my glasses and I move right in. And this works better for me. I go through the print from this distance, which is, I'm about 4 inches away from print. And I go through the whole print like that. Oops, this fell over. So, I will go through the whole print and spot every spot. And then I'm done. And I don't know. I'm gonna get the camera, see if you can see this. Obviously these two spots are not done yet. But this, I spotted three spots here. But if you look carefully, I don't know how close this video recorder can get and stay in focus. But you can see some spots here. Now there are a couple of spots that are in the other image that's in the film. I mean, it's in the image. It must be a piece of the leaves
hanging off the leaf. So I'm going to spot that because it's distracting. Now keep in mind that the spotting tones, the spot tones, they're dyes, you know, and comes in a bottle, they're wet, pour it on something like that, you let it dry over a period of 24 or 36 hours, and then you just use it very little. So, but they're dyes. This is not, this is a metallic silver image suspended in a gelatin emulsion. So that's a metal image, and it's going to last thousands of years, according to estimates. The oldest photograph is, what, 250 years old? And it's still around. So they're just guessing how long it would last, but you don't have to guess about those. That fades. So in anywhere from 10 to 20 years, the spot tone will fade and you'll need to re-spot it. People do give that service. People give you an old Ansel Adams they bought 20, 30 years ago and ask you to re-spot it. And you can do that even if it's mounted. Ideally, you'll want to rewash it so then you can retone it, give it a stronger black, and you have to respot everything once you wash it. But keep in mind that dyes are not light stable, and that's why all color photographs, whether it be a conventional photograph or an inkjet, will fade, because those are, even if they're pigments as opposed to dyes, they will change over a period of time. But a silver image changes very little, as I showed you in the Louis Armstrong that I measured on a densitometer. It went from 2.5 to 2.16 over a period of 35 years, you know, and that's being displayed. So you're not going to get that kind of longevity in any color process. Even cibachromes or dye transfers, they still evade. Dye transfers are also obviously imaged from dyes. Okay, so that's my complete process. The edge is finished. They're flat. The chemicals have been washed out of the front as well as the back. After I spot them, they're completed. I usually mark on the back what the name of the image is and who the photographer is, and the fact that I printed it, and then I'm done. Then I store it in these archival boxes. These are color prints. I made a series of color prints before I closed the lab, and I actually have some 6 foot by 10 feet rolled up in these boxes up there that I printed before I closed the lab. I don't know what to do with them. I still have like 9 portfolios of bobs that I could sell. And I have images by Annie. Her favorite images printed, and I think they're signed. I think I had her sign them. And in black and white, I only have a couple of boxes. But let's see how far I get in printing. At this point, the lessons are almost over. I only have one more section to add at this point. I will do that, and then the lessons are done. I wanted to kind of have an epilogue to all this, and so when I get that, I'll put it all together and I'll post it on YouTube. And I think everything comprises just about over 7 hours of lessons. And all technical, most people watching 5 minutes at most, so I don't expect a lot of viewing. Anyway, I'll be back to finish this, and I'll take my time to spot that. I'm not going to do it right now. Okay? I'll be back. Okay, here we are. Back on the same sofa I was sitting 8 months ago when I started these lessons. And this long video is going to be the last. I might put out more videos, but only if I feel like a demonstration of certain techniques is helpful. Like I got a question about processing 120 film, so eventually I'll demonstrate that in the dark room with the lights on, using water to demonstrate how I process 120 film in a dark room. I'll get around to that eventually, and that'll be added. But this is officially the last video concerning my lessons, and we covered paper response to density range, the zone system in theory and practice, and then film masking and how to address certain deficiencies in the bottom zones of a negative, even if it's correctly exposed and processed. And this last video showed you how I make actual prints, and I put the two prints behind me that we made, you know, that we trimmed and spotted, so I just put that in the background. So I hope that these videos are helpful. And I thought it'd be good to have an afterword, so to speak, about why I did all this. I really do feel like film is, photography is always going to be around, especially black and white. Color is, it's so much easier to do color sufficiently with inkjet technology, that color photography may one day just disappear altogether. Dye transfer's already gone. Chromogenic prints require so many controls, and but black and white should be around for a long time, and that's why I made these lessons addressing black and white. I hope color and photography stays as well. Real color photography in a dark room. And then about 3 weeks ago, I have a good friend, Tom, who is a very good photographer. He used to shoot film and work in a dark room, and eventually he's gone to digital photography. And he has a number of friends that are all very enthusiastic about digital photography. So, I invited Tom out for lunch one day, and he had an interesting question. And I thought it would be appropriate to end these lessons with my lunch with Tom. One of the photographers said to Tom, he says, "When I shoot in the snow, I automatically open up two stops. Do you do that?" And Tom goes, "No, I don't do anything differently. You have the digital capture to look at, to refer to adjust your exposure if you need it. You have the histogram to look at, and why would you automatically open up two stops?" And then a third person came in and had said, "I opened up one stop." And when Tom said that, I just thought, okay, so when we sat down to eat at a restaurant, I picked up a white plate, and I said, "You know, Tom, let's say you're taking a picture of this plate, and that's all you saw was just the plate. The frame of the camera frame completely filled up with the plate. Well, the camera doesn't know you're shooting a plate, a white plate at that. And if everything was calibrated correctly, you had the right ISO and white light balance, and everything was set correctly, then what your camera would indicate is an exposure to make that plate gray, a middle gray, as a matter of fact, pretty dark. Middle gray would be, well, darker than this. And so if you wanted to photograph snow and not have it look gray, you wanted to look, then indeed you would add two stops. But as soon as you had trees and leaves, and maybe you had a person in there, and the sun was falling on that person's face, on one side of the face, if you added two stops, you just blow all that detail away. So you don't want to automatically just open up two stops when you're shooting in the snow. And immediately Tom understood. He was, oh, okay, now it makes sense. And he said that he just, when he shoots in the snow, he basically uses experience. And then I said, you know, when I worked in the photo industry for many years, I cut my teeth copying. You know, working in the copy room, and it was very, very informative. I mean, I learned a lot about filters, different lights, different types of film, matching the lighting, and whether you're using electronic flash or tungsten lights, you have different types of films, black and white color. There were reflections, how to get the light even so that you didn't have fall off on the edge of the, you had to balance the lights and use a meter and go around and you know, it was very, it was a real good education to have spent years in a copy room. And shooting paintings, sometimes you get too many reflections. Sometimes you would feather the lights on paintings so that you would get the texture of the oil paints. But sometimes the oil painting had a lot of detail in the dark areas as well as the texture, so then you had to back off the lights and make a second exposure, lighting it more conventionally so that you could get the best of both worlds. You know, we would copy with a process camera, and the back of the camera would open up, you put the film was held down with vacuum, and you left it up and you could shoot again and again without the artwork or the film moving. So copying was really, really good experience. And for the most part, we shot for reproduction. So sometimes you shoot slides for slideshows. People would give us, advertising agencies would give us magazine articles, ads, we'd copy it and it'd be used. But in many instances, we were given paintings, watercolors, artwork that would be reproduced. So then we would have to make the transparency look as close as possible to the original artwork, because they would scan our transparencies and go to reproduction, and they refer to the transparency for color. That's why we put in a grayscale on the edge of the artwork so that the printer could refer to the grayscale. And so accuracy of color and tonal range was all important when you're doing copying. But copying is not photography, it's just a part of photography. So I explained this to Tom, and I said, you know, whatever is in front of the camera when you shoot, that's just a starting point. If you feel something from a scene, you may want to capture in such a way that expresses that feeling better than a regular copy photograph would convey. And then I pointed at a reflection on the floor. I said, look at that reflection, it's so bright, but yet within that brightness, you can see different tones. You can see the texture on that floor. And if you place that reflection in zone 5, if you actually shot in zone 5 or zone 6, which is pretty gray, this is approximately zone 6. then everything else would follow. Obviously the shadow would go black, but then the texture, you would see that texture a lot better. And then you'd see the minute differences between, within that reflection. And that's a totally different way of seeing, and it's a viable way to photograph. And Tom understood what I said, and he didn't really have anything to say after that. And so after I said that, I thought, well, maybe I should do that and shoot something like that to end these lessons. So even though that I had finished the previous video 3 weeks ago, and I stopped and I started thinking about working on another photograph just to demonstrate this. And so here it is 3 weeks later, and I've done that. And I came across, I was at a front door, and the front door has a sheet of textured glass. I thought, well, if I shot through that glass with the sun coming through, and I made that into a full tone print, it might be interesting to capture that texture to see what. And so that's what I did, and I shot this being the glass, and this is just a door, but because of the exposure, this went black. And then with masking, it came out like this. So now, from black to white, I have this texture, which, because the lighting wasn't perfect to capture all that detail in the dark shadow, so with masking, I was able to separate that, and like I showed in previous videos. But when I had to open the front door, I forgot to say this, but my tripod was in the car, so I had to go through the front door and get my tripod. It had been raining for like a solid week, 7 days of rain, and when I opened the door that morning, the rain had stopped, and the sky was filled with these clouds, and it just occurred to me that, wow, what a beautiful day that today is. And that feeling came across me, which quite often happens when I look at clouds. I mean, clouds are something that Alfred Stieglitz used to shoot and called it his equivalence, because if clouds have a certain feeling to them, and every cloud is different. And so I thought, well, I should shoot the clouds. So I got the tripod, I shot that, and then I shot the clouds. Now the clouds were a different matter. It was similar to reflection in that I figured if I shot the whites of the clouds, now I can't use even with a spot mirror, I can't go into a cloud and capture all the different shades in the high values and the highlights of the cloud. So if I just metered the bright areas of the clouds and placed it in zone 5 or 6, and I gave it expanded development so that I could stretch out that detail from the purest white to the light areas and processed zone 5 into zone 7, then I would expand the area of the clouds to the sky. And that's what I did. So I shot that. Obviously, it was a very short exposure, shooting right into the sky, into the clouds. I think I used 500th of a second at f32. And then I processed for 20 minutes. And I got this. So this is what I got. Now this is after. Now obviously when I metered, this is all below zone 0. I metered here and placed that in zone 5. And I expanded the development. So I got all, and so now the clouds are really soft, which is often how I see clouds. Generally speaking, they're blown out, and this is dark. It comes out pretty contrasty when you just shoot the sky. With masking, I was able to hold a little bit of detail I got in this window here. I don't know if you can see that. And the mask extended somewhat into, even into the clouds, because in this case, I made a very heavy mask in order to retain this detail and keep these blacks. So I thought I would end this session. I couldn't make a big print like that because I ran out of paper. I'm gonna get some money and I'll buy another roll. So I made this, and also I wanted to say that since I started shooting these videos, I have been pretty active on YouTube looking at videos, photography videos that other people have put on. There's a lot on YouTube. Most of it is on digital photography, but some is on film. And I watched a bit of both. Every day, actually, I've been watching videos on YouTube on photography. And there is one thing that I don't do much of, I've done a little bit of, but it's talked about quite a bit on YouTube, and that's split filter printing. And since I'm printing on multi-grade, quite honestly, I would prefer to print on number 2 grade paper, but I don't know if I can find rolls of number 2 paper. Everyone offers rolls of paper in multi-grade, and I think it's because it's so flexible. But multi-grade allows you to expose, because multi-grade paper has a polycontrast filter. A polycontrast paper has 2 layers of emulsion. One is sensitive to yellow, and the other one is sensitive to blue. The more blue exposure, more contrast, more exposure to the yellow layer, and you get lower contrast. So there's a procedure which there are excellent videos on YouTube about this, of making one exposure through a low contrast filter and another exposure through a high contrast filter, and then you can print a very nice black and white print without any burning and dodging. So I decided to do that with this. So this one, and it works really well, you know. Actually, because it's been masked, it's not difficult to print anyway. But this particular exposure, okay, so another thing I have to mention. I don't use multi-grade filters. I have a color head, like I said. I learned a long time ago not to put filters in front of the lens because it degrades the image. You lose definition, especially when you're making large prints. So Ilford used to make enlarger that had filters above the negative, and that's the best way to go. And I don't know if they still make that head, but in the videos, and I'll put a link on the description for this video on how to, on one of the videos that shows split filter printing. They recommend using a 0 filter and making, well, first they tell you to make an exposure to get roughly what you want with a grade 2.5. And then they cut in half and give half the exposure with a high contrast number 5 filter and half the exposure with a 0 filter. And that's your starting point. And that worked pretty well for this. So this actually got, and for my 0 filter, I used 50 yellow. And this received 12 seconds with 50 yellow in the head. Then I dialed the yellow to 0, and I added my maximum magenta, which was 170 magenta, and it received 9 seconds of, so roughly half, 9 seconds and 12 seconds, and it made this print. And I can see, now when I get some paper, I'll make a 16 by 20 of this, maybe 20 by 24, because it's very elegant. You know, I like the feeling it has. And then when I shot this, though, I shot 2 negatives. Mostly because of dust. You know, this film is cut from 8x10. I cut 4x5 from 8, so there's, but anyway, I shot 2, and there's this one has no mask on it. And it also went through split filter printing. But this one had only 2 seconds at 170 magenta and 20 seconds at 50 yellow. And I'll zoom in later and you can see this better. But you don't see the window because there's no mask on this egg. This is the second egg I shot. And I didn't mask this one. And you can see it's a little bit different because the clouds have moved here. This is quite different, this corner. So without a mask in place, it still works, but you don't have the detail that the mask provided, obviously. The D-Max is the same. This only had 2 seconds in order to get the black. And so split filtering is a neat way of printing, which I never really did. Now, the way I did it before was I would print, like normally I use, 30 magenta or whatever. And if I needed to burn in a high value, I could remove the 30 magenta, burn the high values in, and that's how I did multi-grade printing before. But in these videos on YouTube, it tells you to give two separate exposures, and then they eliminate any burning and dodging, which it works to a certain extent pretty well. And there is mention in one of the books, which I tried to find, like one of books published of Ansel Adams' works. He did a print of I think it was in a portrait book. It was a print of someone sitting in a chair in the sunlight, and he did exactly this. He gave it an overall exposure, and then he changed the filter pack, and he burnt one area, and then he changed the filter pack, and he burnt another area to give it contrast where he wanted, and lowered the contrast. And he says, this print could not have been done with any other paper except for a polycontrast type paper, unless he uses complicated masking procedure. It's the only time in any of his books he mentions masking, film masking. So, and obviously he knew about film masking, but according to John Sexton, he never used it for any of his own work. Hopefully I took the masking procedure, outlined it so it's not too complicated, and you can see the benefits of it. And lastly, I will say that I try to photograph what I feel. So now I'm acutely aware of everything. I try to be very aware of everything I see. And sometimes I'll see something like this, and I'll feel something. I say, oh, if I could only capture that in a photograph, how would I do that? And given all these techniques that I know, I try to capture some of that feeling. I don't think that artists, as a rule, can begin to capture in sculpture form or in print form, photographic form or painting, the beauty that is in Mother Nature. Nature provides us with everything. We can only try to capture the feeling. We can't really capture the beauty that nature is. We can try to do some of it. And interestingly enough, when we go through our day, we kind of take everything for granted. We take Mother Nature for granted. We don't. And it takes an artist to wake us up and say, wait a minute, take a look at this. This is part of the world we live in. And that appreciation for what we already have is kind of what artists do. It's kind of like wake us up. So when I opened the front door and I see the sky and I go, wow, look at that sky. If I could capture part of that, that's what I'm gonna do. Because I don't travel a lot. I don't have the funds to travel around the world and go to all these great places. I'm too old to go camp. I can't sleep on the ground anymore and go backpacking in the woods. But what I do now is I just try to see beauty wherever it lies and I try to capture it somehow. And that to me is what photography is. And, you know, making an actual print is what makes photography somewhat similar to painting, sculpture. It's a physical thing. It's not, you know, capturing a great image and sharing it on your iPhone or on the internet is great. There's nothing wrong with that. But if you can put something up that actually exists three-dimensionally, then it's kind of like your contribution as an artist to this world to add to the existence. And believe it or not, that photograph that you make has a consciousness of its own. This is actually spoken about in quantum physics. Everything has consciousness. So when we impart our attention to painting, sculpture, even piece of music, photograph, we leave a bit of our contribution towards the consciousness of that art piece. And that's why I made these lessons, and that's why I work so much in this industry doing what it is I know how to do now, which is not much, but it's something. So those are my lessons, and thanks for watching. If you watch, this is probably close to 3 hours, this one, and I'm going to cut to a close-up of these last two images so that you can take a look at them side by side, okay?